your name today, O God, and we exalt you in the house today. And Lord God, we invoke your holy name and say, let your presence shine in the house today, O God. Fill this house with your glory, Lord, so that each one here will have a divine encounter with you. We give you thanks for it even now, O God, for what you will do in this service. Let your name, O God, be magnified among your people today, so that everyone, God, those who are here and those who are tuning in, will know that they have been in your presence. Have your way in us and through us. In the mighty name of Christ Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
congregational meeting, March 26th at 9:30 a.m. We will be meeting in the hall at St. George's on March 26th. I will send you an email reminder. So that is coming up. And then just to remind you that next Sunday, we mark the International Day for the Elimination of Racial Discrimination. That's our annual service. And we ask you to be here to celebrate, to mark that with us as our commitment to continue to fight against racism. And, you know, I am a part of the Anti-Black Racism Task Force of the AVA and the CBAC, our Canadian Baptists of Atlantic Canada. And all during Lent, we are posting meditation, devotion, video clips of church leaders across Atlantic Canada and students, leaders and students, for anti-black racism. And I encourage you to go out either to the AUBA website or to the CBAC website and watch the videos. A new one is posted every Wednesday and Friday. Wednesday and Friday, there's a new video, and then during Holy Week, one will be posted all over. So I just want to remind you of that as well. We're going to be approaching prayer time soon, but just because, you know, age and stage, somebody say age and stage. I better tell you all I'm thinking of. Amen. We want to remember the Simmons family in prayer today, the tragic loss in that family. And then, of course, we got the news that our own sister Gail Sparks lost her daughter. She passed away last week. And so we're praying for all of those who are grieving the loss of loved ones. Right now, I invite you to, here it comes, Mr. Mayor, to give your attention to Brother George Moore. He wants to come and share with us this morning.
Thank God, it's good to be in the house. Yeah. Amen. Yeah. Amen. Thank you. It's been a long time, but better late than never. Right? I'm just gonna bear with me. I'm a little scatterbrained. Anyway, how did he say the topic this morning? Imagine a swimmer who's gone out into deep water and is drowning. She cries to the lifeguard to save her. The lifeguard rushes to where she is, picks her up, her helpless condition, and takes her to shore. The lifeguard has saved her from drowning. Or imagine a man who is trapped in a burning building and is quickly being overcome by smoke. He sees a firefighter coming toward him and cries out for help. The firefighter picks him up in his helpless condition, takes him out of the building. The firefighter has saved him from perishing in the fire. In the same way, God has provided a Savior, Jesus Christ, who is able to rescue every sinner who trusts in Him. No matter what you've done, He can save you. We need to be saved. Because of our rebellion against God, you and I are in danger of eternal separation from Him. The separation will mean being banished from the presence of God, who is the source of all good. James 1:17. It will also mean eternal punishment as we suffer the consequences of our sin. The Bible says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is death. It is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. Whosoever has not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. What has the Savior done? well, Lord Jesus Christ, because the Savior of sinners, that includes you and me, for coming down from heaven and dying on the cross for our sins. God raised him from the dead. He is now being Savior at God's right hand in heaven. God commands his love toward us in that while we were sinners, yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ died for our sins, was buried, and rose again the third day. Christ also hath once suffered for sin, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but quickened by the Spirit. How can you be saved? Well, the only way for us to be saved from our sins and their punishment is to turn to God in repentance and place our faith in Jesus Christ. To repent is to realize and acknowledge that we are in serious trouble, just like the drowning swimmer, just like the firefighter. To place our faith in the Lord Jesus as Savior is to believe that he has fully paid the price for forgiveness and cleansing by bearing our sins, his own body on the cross. The Lord Jesus will save you the moment you trust you put your full trust weight of sin on him. No good works of ours and anything else we can do can possibly put one of the countless sins away. The only thing that we can do God will accept is to place our faith in Jesus Christ, trusting him to save us. By grace are you saved through faith and not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, that any man should boast. He that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from death unto life. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth, Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with our heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Amen. God is going to do well. A couple of things I put together, just bear with me. And I have chosen a few psalms, just in one verse, and a full verse of one, okay? Is that okay? My pianos. Did you get a copy of this? No. Okay, Pastor said we're running out of time, so I'll just finish this off with can't even walk.
I thought number one would surely be I could be what I wanted to be. I thought I could live on life's sinking sand, but I can't even walk without you holding my
birthday.
Our gracious and everlasting Lord, once again, we just thank you for taking care of us and watching us through another week. We just give you back a portion that you so willingly give to us. Just bless the hands that are able to give and those who are unable to give at this time. May we use this for your building of your kingdom here on earth. All these things we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ.
I'm
struggling with homelessness during this season, unhoused. This is still a question, I guess, a discussion that is going on in our government as far as what we can do to help people and remember who we are as the Church of God and trying to come alongside and help people in difficult times. We also remember those who are suffering in Ukraine, during this war, and praying God's protection on His people. Prepare your hearts now.
Our eyes on you, no matter what.
Habakkuk. You told him, as you work out your plans for the Israelite people in his day, you are working out your plans for us today. Lord, these plans are painful. These plans give us cause to cry, to moan. But praise be to God. Your plans give us cause to rejoice, to dance for joy, because we know that you are doing things all things well.
Yes.
It hurts. And our ears tingle as we hear what is going on around the world. Yes, the Ukraine, it has only pushed the other wars and movement of people off the front page. But this has been going on for so long. So many people have no hope, and in some cases, no hope. But Lord, in you we have hope. We know that you know, and you do all things well. For that we praise you, we thank you, we glorify your name. And Lord, I would not forget to thank you for Brother George celebrating his birthday. It's wonderful, and it's wonderful to be in the house with your people. But your people are all around the world, as we saw pictures of people in the Ukraine, in Russia, and that kneeling in the snow, crying out to the Lord. Because, Lord, there is no place else to go. And it's sad that we only remember that when we are in pain. Forgive us, Lord. We come before your throne asking forgiveness, not only for us, but for those whom we forgive. Because sometimes, Lord, we forget to forgive others who have wronged us. And I ask for your forgiveness. And I praise you, I glorify your name. Be exalted. In Habakkuk, he says, when the Lord said, what I am about to do will make your ears tingle, and you're not going to believe me. When Habakkuk was told, he said, Lord, what you are doing, who you are using, is worse than our people. And that's true. God can use the most ungodly people to bring us to our knees, to bring us to him and to cry out, Lord, forgive, forgive, forgive. Wash me, cleanse me, and use me according to your will. Thank you, Lord. Many people among us are suffering loss. There's been loss in my family. Many are straying away, and so many of our people are saying, this is my life, and I'll do what I want. And my question is, so how is it going? And the answer is always, not well. It doesn't go well when we think that we can and are in charge of our own lives, because Lord, we are not even in charge of the next breath, because you hold us in your hand. You made us for yourself to worship, praise, and glorify you. And you claim us for yourself. And we can do nothing. Nothing. Is prosperous or
closer to the eternal hope of one day being in the presence of our Lord and Savior Jesus. So at this time, I'm going to pause. And those who have concerns, just speak them out. Cry out to the Lord.
Thank you.
They were already what? Oh, Jesus!
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 My Jesus!
How I love!
I love!
Open your gate!
Oh, Jesus!
Jesus!
My lily of the valley!
Jesus!
My morning star!
Every day! Your name is the same!
I remember the time I felt so all alone. Oh, when I needed you, Jesus, all I had to do was call. Sometimes it was in the morning, sometimes late at night. Oh, when I got up on my knees, Lord, everything was all right. Oh, Jesus,
Jesus,
every day
how I love to call. It is because we didn't bring any bread. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked,
you of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Don't you remember the 5 loaves for the 5,000? And how many basketfuls you gathered? Or the 7 loaves for the 4,000? And how many basketfuls you gathered? How is it you don't understand that I was not talking to you about bread? But be on your guard against the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees. Then they understood that he was not telling them to guard against the yeast used in bread, but against the teaching of the Pharisees and Sadducees. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You on the thought? Focus. Focus. It's a reprise. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, now in this moment of proclamation, we invite you to open up this word to our understanding, and we are grateful that you care enough to send us a word. Help us, O Lord, to receive it, to believe it, and then give us the strength to live it. We thank you, O God, as we stand on your truth that says, when your word goes out, it does not return unto you void, but accomplishes the purpose for which it has been sent. And so we believe, Lord, that you are doing a work in us. When we can't see it, when we can't feel it, Lord, you are working. And we give you thanks for that. In the name of Christ Jesus, let me decrease now so that you would increase and to come forth as you would have it. This is our prayer. Amen. Today we find ourselves, our heroes, I should say, moving about, ultimately heading toward Caesarea Philippi, where they sometimes went for retreat and refreshment. And on their way, we see at the end of chapter 15 that they make an interim stop or pass through a place Matthew refers to as Magadan. This name is found nowhere else in the scripture, and it is suggested that it may be a reference to Magdala. The Hebrew translation means harp in one form, and to cut, invade, or expose in another form. Some commentators think Matthew may have been using Magadan intentionally as a pun. First, as a nod to King David, as a musician who offered songs to God that held prophecy for the expected Messiah. But also as a reference to Jonah, who was ejected from the belly of the big fish on the shore in the vicinity of Magdala. When Jonah landed, he exclaimed, "Salvation is from the Lord." And of course, in the opening of this chapter, in his response to the request of the Pharisees for a sign, Jesus says the only sign they would receive would be the sign of Jonah. The Pharisees and Sadducees were constantly trying to trip Jesus up. They were always trying to catch him out, to get him to say something that would incriminate him or give them cause to have him arrested. We talk about them a lot, but do you remember who they were? They were both learned groups of people. The Pharisees claimed Moses and the law of Moses as their guide for faith and living. They believed in the supernatural, like angels and demons, heaven and hell. They demanded the people obey all the law, and they loved to judge other people, never seeing their own faults. Jesus called them blind guides. The Sadducees were the rich folks who were more associated with the temple and the priesthood. They made the sacrifices and maintained the temple order and purity. They did not embrace the supernatural. They had a greater love of money and love to lord their authority over others. So Jesus, who came reinterpreting the teachings of Moses and asserting the spirit over the law, while also upsetting the status quo in terms of ritual sacrifices and how sins are forgiven. Jesus, who came embracing people who the temple gatekeepers may have shunned, Jesus came and put both these groups on edge. Of course, we must be careful not to lump them all together. We know that there were some whose hearts were touched when they heard Jesus. But for the majority in these two religious sects, as Jesus gained popularity, the Pharisees and Sadducees increasingly saw him as a threat and wanted him gone. We talk about them, but I want you to remember who they are, because they are still intimidated, they are still angered, they are still feeling territorial today. After Jesus shut these seekers of a sign down, Jesus moves on with his posse. We don't know how much time has passed, but they have had enough time to get in a boat and cross the Sea of Galilee, which is the Lake of Gennesaret. So it's not an ocean. We all hear the Sea of Galilee and we think it's an ocean, but it's really a lake. It is possibly mid-crossing when Jesus utters the warning about the yeast of the Pharisees. Jesus always used examples and illustrations that the people of his day could relate to. So if you have ever baked bread, or you're familiar with baking, you know that yeast is used to make the bread rise. The dough only requires a smidgen of yeast, not much at all. That is because yeast contains active microscopic cultures. Those live microorganisms spread quickly and easily throughout the whole dough. Jesus warned about the yeast because the infusion of dangerous ideas spreads profusely. Have you ever noticed how quickly bad news, evil ideas, negative words, how easily that stuff spreads? And in these days of social media, the negative spreads very quickly. People seem inclined toward the negative, always want you to spill the tea. We have the best news in the world. Do we spread it?
Yes.
Brother George Stewart here gave us the whole gospel. Yes. I said, I don't even need to preach today. Gave us the whole gospel. Do we spread it?
Yes.
When Jesus utters about yeast, the disciples start talking about bread. Jesus is using an example they can relate to, but they lose focus. So the Lord redirects their focus so they may see past the temporal into the spiritual. You of little faith, why are you talking among yourselves about having no bread? Did you not just learn the lesson of the loaves? You just saw me. You helped me feed 4,000 plus, and then you helped me feed 5,000 plus with a few loaves of bread and a few fish. Bread is not the problem. How many know God provides all we need? We don't have to worry about provision. That's not the problem. You will not starve. Focus. I'm talking to you about the kingdom. I'm trying to get you to see. I'm trying to get you to be on your guard. Focus. Can you imagine Jesus sometimes trying to teach these disciples? Work with me, people. Focus. It's not about bread. It's not about provision. Don't you know God has every provision? God owns everything. God only needs to speak and it's done.
Yes.
Hallelujah. Even when we don't see it, he's working.
Yes.
There were dangerous factions teaching people falsely about God and how people were to live. Jesus came with a new revelation, brought new understanding, clarified some things, and gave people a new focus, not on the letter of the law, but on the Spirit. Focus not on hate, not on the evil plans, Reverend told us, that human beings devise to destroy. Focus on the good plans of God for us. Focus not on hate, but on love. Focus not on revenge or retaliation, but on forgiveness. Focus not on self, but on others. Focus not on judging, but on compassion. These teachings, these ideas that all people are worthy of dignity and respect, and all are included in God's love and care, were not what the Pharisees and Sadducees wanted to hear. And this is not unlike today. It is not what those who have always occupied the seats of power in our world want to hear. It is not what colonizers and settlers who think that indigenous peoples are beneath them want to hear. They are the Pharisees and Sadducees of our day. When the former U.S. president came on the scene and he started his campaign with dangerous ideas, most of us laughed and thought he would not go far. And yet he was elected. It was unbelievable. It was impossible. It was ludicrous. How could this happen? How could the public allow such a thing to happen? And yet it did. The dangerous yeast had spread throughout the entire country. And there were many who absorbed and spread his vicious, vile, and violent messages. And even today, after more than a year of being out of office, his ideologies continue to rule in the hearts of many people who do not want to see those persons in society who have been marginalized receive any justice. They do not want to see equity. They do not want to address the wrongs that have been done. They do not even want to acknowledge any wrong has been done. They rise up against simple things that could help all of society, all of the world, such as simply wearing a mask to protect against the pandemic. They demand their rights as citizens while denying the rights of others. It is no doubt that many of these ideas, many of these wicked ideologies were asleep, lying dormant in the hearts of evil people all along, but they were awakened when the perfect storm of evil messaging met with power and authority in the office of the United States President. They produced evil fruit. What had been sleeping was awakened with new strength because of a little yeast spread in the dough. Around the world, this yeast continues to spread. Look at what is happening in Ukraine for no other reason than a lust for power. Here in Nova Scotia, we have experienced injustices, perhaps because of this yeast. The talks we have been having, the dawning of understanding in the minds of people since the murder of George Floyd, the awareness that something needs to be done to address the issues of inequity and injustice in our society in regards to marginalized people had begun to take root. Those ideas had begun to take root, but as soon as we see progress in our society, we see backlash by what looks like a spreading of the same poisonous yeast. Seeks to thwart the efforts of those who were trying to do good those who are trying to make a change, those who are trying to open doors. Some days it looks like we're going backward. But I want to encourage you this morning, church, not to rely on your natural eye, but to wait on the Lord and watch God's move in the spiritual. Greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Yes. Yes, 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 Lord. I feel my help coming on. I'm so glad that we serve a God who is keeping watch over us. We serve a God who watches over his word and is faithful to perform it. We serve a God who never leaves. God, but we just have to hold to God's unchanging hand. Beware of negative talk. Beware of dismay. Beware of that so easily spreads throughout the dough to discourage you. Hallelujah, to disappoint you, to make you feel discontented. Beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. In Christ Jesus, we have an advocate who feeds us. We don't have to worry about bread, amen. He feeds us, and he provides for us. And God will work it out, church. Trust in the Lord and do good. Keep your eyes on the prize.
Thank you.
We have done this day as the Lord has commanded, and yet there is room. I again remind you that on March 26th, it's our next quarterly meeting, 9:30 a.m. at St. George's Hall. And I also remind you that we have Advent folders at the back. If you didn't get one last week, please pick up one this week and start. And we will collect them on the Sunday after Easter. That's our anniversary Sunday. Actually, I should remind you about that our anniversary service is on April 24th, when we will be celebrating our 190th anniversary. We'll have our 12 noon service, I should say, here at St. Matthew's as usual, but we also have a 3 p.m. service. It's going to be happening at St. George's at 3 o'clock with our guest preacher, Pastor Matthew Thomas. So I invite you to get excited about that. Amen. We'll be back at the neighborhood at 3 o'clock to celebrate our 190th anniversary. Please receive the benediction. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before his presence in glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, with glory and majesty, dominion, and power, from this time forth and even forevermore. Amen.